Okay, we're going to go ahead and call the City of Panama City Planning Board meeting of March 9th, 2015, to order. If you would, please take the roll.
Robbie Hughes. Carl Russ.
Here.
Waylon Graham. Mary Sitman.
Here.
Ray Dubuque.
Here. I will remind everyone, the items on today's agenda, unless they are tabled, will be heard by the City Commission at their meeting on Tuesday, March 24th at 8 a.m. in this room. They make the final decision on any items that come before us. We strictly make recommendations to them. So, and also, for any of you that have not been to a meeting before, let me kind of give you a little bit of information about how it will be handled. The staff will present an item. The board will ask the staff any questions they might have. The applicant will be allowed an opportunity to address the board if they have anything they would like to add or answer any questions from the board. And then the audience, and if you're here for an item, you will be given a chance to express your opinion on that item. So then after that, the board will make a recommendation one way or the other on each item. Are there any changes or deletions to the agenda?
No.
Okay, seeing none. The minutes of February 9th meeting were previously provided. If you've had a chance, if there are no additions, deletions, or corrections, I'll entertain a motion to approve those minutes.
So moved.
So we have a motion and a second. Ms. Sitman motioned and Mr. Russ second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Just, that's good enough for that. All right. Announcements or disclosures? Any announcements or disclosures? Would you prefer on the disclosures we do it as we get to the item or all up front? Doesn't matter to you?
It's your call, sir.
All right. Let's do it as we get to the item. I think that makes it a little clearer in everyone's mind. So item number one.
This is a request for a small-scale land use amendment and a rezoning for the property located at 3610 West 17th Street. The owner is the First Church of the Nazarene of Panama City, and Sean McNeil is the representative for the owner. The property is just over an acre in size. It is in the X-flood zone, and it is outside the coastal high hazard area and inside the hurricane vulnerability zone. And it is also in the St. Andrews Historic Neighborhood Overlay District. The property is presently zoned mixed use one, and the request is to rezone the property to public institutional and also. Okay. So this is a request for a small scale land use amendment and a rezoning for the property at 3610 West 17th Street. The owner is the First Church of the Nazarene of Panama City, and Sean McNeil is the representative for the owner. The property is just over 1 acre in size, and it is in the X flood zone and outside the coastal high hazard area and inside the hurricane vulnerability zone. It is located inside the St. Andrews Historic Neighborhood Overlay as well. The property is presently zoned mixed use one and is developed with a church, and the request is to rezone the property to public institutional and also to have the related land use amendment for that as well. So, as I stated, the property is presently developed with the church, and the property owner plans to develop a parking lot to serve the existing building. There is a gravel area there right now that appears to be used for parking, but the property owner would like to pave that and install some landscaping. So the current zoning designation of mixed use one allows a maximum impervious surface ratio of 0.5 or 50%, which the building and the planned parking lot area will exceed. So therefore, the property owner is requesting that the property be rezoned to public institutional, which has a maximum ISR of 90%. As we said, it is currently a church, and my understanding is they plan to continue using it as a church with those parking lot improvements. The utilities director has indicated that water and sewer service are currently available to the property. You also have before you in the staff report the comprehensive plan future land use element as it pertains to the public institutional land use category, including the standards for development within that category. Finally, you have before you the land development regulation provisions as they pertain to requests for land use changes and rezonings, and the four criteria that apply to these requests. The first is that the request not degrade the established level of services in the comprehensive plan or the minimum concurrency requirements. We did do a concurrency analysis, and that is included in the back of the staff report, and we did not find any deficiencies would result from this land use change and rezoning. The second point is that the request be in harmony with the general intent of the comprehensive plan. We have listed the goals, the relevant goals from the comprehensive plan that pertain to this request, and we find that the request is consistent with those. The third criteria is that the request not exceed traffic limitations, create a fire hazard, or a hazard to the public health, welfare, and safety. We don't anticipate that that will do so, particularly since the use of the property will not substantially change. And finally, the request must be compatible with the adjacent land uses and districts and not create a potential nuisance. This property is located in a residential neighborhood south of the Highway 98 commercial corridor. Property adjacent on all sides of the subject property is zoned mixed use one and developed with single family homes. The subject property, however, has been developed with and used as a church for quite some time. It looks like from the property appraiser site that there has been, this building has been on the site since the 50s, so presumably it's blended in with the neighborhood, so to speak. So a zoning designation of PI would allow the church to enhance its use of the property, but would not permit any commercial uses or high-density residential uses that might pose a conflict. So we do find that public institutional land use in a PI zoning would be appropriate in this location for this particular use. So in summary, we find the request is consistent with the LDRs and the comprehensive plan. And
go ahead.
I was just going to say, this is the land use map, and also, Daryl, can you forward it for me, please? The zoning map, and then one forward is the site plan. Can you forward again, please? Thank you. This is a site plan or proposed site plan for the property showing the church and the proposed parking lot.
For those members of the audience, what we're looking at in front of us is the same thing you're seeing up on that screen. So let me ask you something. What are most churches zoned in Panama City?
It's something of a mix. Many of them are zoned public institutional. There are some that are in commercial districts, and so they happen to have commercial zoning and land use designations. There are also some that are in mixed use districts and residential districts. It's a bit of a mixed bag.
If someone was to propose a new church somewhere, what would you recommend that zoning be?
Well, public institutional is the zoning district that specifically allows institutions, although churches do have a certain amount of latitude for where they locate.
Okay. Any other questions for staff?
Okay. I'd just like for the record to point out that I've made it here. I'm sorry that I was late. And if you can put that on the record, thank
you. Name and address. That's one thing I failed to mention. I'm sorry. But when you come to the podium, we will need your name and address for the record. So.
Good afternoon. Thank you, Chairman. Sean McNeil with McNeil Carroll Engineering, 475 Harrison Avenue. I really can't add much to what Anna said. Just want to introduce Pastor Roberts is here with the church. We'll be happy to entertain any questions you may have of the applicant or the owner.
So this is strictly to pave the parking lot, basically?
Yes. Yes.
To get the coverage on.
Yes, sir. Okay.
Questions for the applicants, representatives?
Thank you.
Seeing none, is there anyone? Yes, ma'am. You have to come to the mic and state your name and address.
Janice Boatwright, 1614 Molitor Avenue, Panama City, Florida, 32401. And my only question comes in regards to the, and this is probably for Sean to answer, as it relates to the stormwater runoff. You know, currently it's, you know, it's a dirt and gravel parking lot, so the absorption, you know, is easy and the water disperses. That corner right there of Molitor and 17th Street will take on a good bit of water when we've had, you know, our dousings of rain as we've had recently. So my question is, what's going to happen when all this area is paved? You know, what has been taken into consideration as far as, you know, getting all that water off of that parking lot? Where's it going? Where's it going to end up? That sort of thing. That's my main question.
Okay, thank you. That's a very valid concern. Sean, would you like to address that?
Yeah, if you look at the site plan on the screen at the top of on Michigan Avenue, Molitor is on the southeast corner of the property, but at the north west corner of the property is where the stormwater is going to be managed, attenuated and discharged onto Michigan Avenue. Yes, yes, that's the retention pond there, kind of. It's the little rectangular shape at the top of the drawing.
Sean, will it be strictly a runoff type, or will there be catch basins per se with drains into it?
Yeah, we're going to have to pipe some of it from the parking lot.
Some piped into it.
Believe it or not, it's kind of flat in that area, so it's actually a pretty tough little stormwater project, but we can handle it, I hope. All right. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else in the audience like to address this item? Okay, seeing none. Any additional questions from the board? If not, do I see a motion? I have a motion.
So moved.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. There's no further discussion. Please take the roll.
Robbie Hughes?
Yes.
Carl Russ?
Yes.
Mary Sittman?
Yes.
Ray Dubuque?
Yes. Thank you. Motion passes. Again, this will be heard at the City Commission meeting on the 24th. Is that right? Right there. Yes, March 24th, 8 a.m. in this office. All right. Second item.
Yes, this is the final approval for the first phase of the Sweet Bay subdivision, which is located on the former Panama City Airport site. 3127 Lisenby Avenue is the former address. And as you probably recall, in 2014, the city approved a preliminary subdivision plat for this property, specifically for the portion of the property south of the terminal where Lisenby enters the site. So at this point, the property owner and applicants have come forward with the first phase of that subdivision for the final platting process, and you see that before you on the screen here for the first several number of lots. So the engineering department took a look at the final plat and offered a few comments. They went out and did a site visit and found that the construction was complete except for the top layer of the pavement. They are suggesting that the city require the applicant or the property owner to have a bond in place for the final layer of pavement prior to the city accepting the final plat. The applicant is aware of that requirement, has indicated that they do not object to doing that. And the engineering department also sent the plat to Countywide Surveying to review the plat on behalf of the city. Countywide had several comments, and they were in contact with Preble Rich for the property owner to straighten out some issues on the plat, and they have done that. The Underground Utilities Department and the Planning and Land Use Departments also reviewed the plat and had no comments. And the Fire Department reviewed the plat and notated that the property needs to have two access points to it. So currently it is accessed off Lisenby Avenue, and there is a construction access from Airport Road. It's a gravel road, but it is accessible, and so the comment from the Fire Department was that that secondary access or some other secondary access needs to remain open until they create a second permanent connection to the street system. So all that being said, we do find that the plat meets our requirements, and we recommend a recommendation of approval of the plat.
Okay. Any questions for staff?
So do we know if the secondary road is what I grew up with was that old little winding road that came off of Airport. Is it that one?
I believe so. If you and I are thinking the same thing, Airport Road still connects from the west toward the terminal, coming east toward the terminal. Although John Sklarski might.
Yeah, we can get.
You know where I'm talking about?
Yeah. We'll get him up here too. Okay, again, please state your name and address for the record.
John Sklarski, Preble Rich, 203 Aberdeen Parkway. The secondary point of access will be what we're calling Airport West. So as you continue past Lisenby on 390 going towards 23rd Street, it's that that next Airport Road with a gas station
right
there. So you go down there where the lift station is, and it kind of bends around, and you come in and you look facing the school.
Mm-hmm.
That's the secondary point of access. There's existing asphalt. There's a little patch of temporary milled asphalt. That's a temporary connection to the new development, and that will be maintained, you know, for school access. You know, the school uses both Airport Road and Lisenby for access points, so we are maintaining both of those access connections throughout the whole duration of the project.
Isn't that the area that we had flooding problems with, and we had people here asking the city to pipe? Isn't that the area?
Mr. Bushmeyer was here, and that's where Airport Road goes up, and Bushmeyer lived just on the south of the property.
Correct.
On
yes,
that side street, and there's a drainage. There was a culvert there. I think they did some work there, but I'm not.
There's
I
a spillway.
The county did.
There's a spillway.
There's a spillway.
That's right. Yeah.
On the east side of Airport Road, and it goes underneath Airport, and then continues down into the bay underneath the Crosswinds culverts there.
Mm-hmm.
Correct. Yeah, there. That is south of our property.
Okay. So he was here asking, is there a way to solve the backup or the flooding problem when we had heavy rains?
Mm-hmm.
I just want to make sure that that secondary point is not compromised in, you know, some sort of act of God that keeps it and keeps the fire department happy. That's really what I'm looking for.
Correct. Yeah, and that's, opinion, the reason for the two access points is in case an act of God occurs on the one, you have the second.
Okay.
So Lisbon people may be maintained. Airport will be maintained. There's at current time, it's not proposed to improve that spillway.
Mm-hmm.
Now, over time, there are funds for the transportation, impacts that are over here allocated, and that could be an enhancement project, but it's not determined at this time.
Okay.
And you're okay with all the stipulations with the bond and all of that stuff?
Yes. So. Yeah, we're working with the contractor. He's given us the number for the final lift, and we'll have that in place this week.
Okay. Any other questions for the applicant? Seeing none. Anybody in the audience to address this? Seeing none. Do I have a motion?
I'll make a motion. We approve the plat. As submitted.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Please take the roll.
Robbie Hughes.
Yes.
Carl Russ.
Yes.
Mary Sittman.
Yes.
Rita Buick.
Yes. Okay. Agenda item number 3, updates to the city land development regulations.
Yes, sir. Let me pass out the latest section that you guys were emailed earlier.
That I haven't had time to print. I've already got that.
In essence, what we have before you tonight are four changes. Basically, the first section includes two definitions, building mass and impervious surface. Item number 2 is the downtown district. We did talk about this last month. I did get with the consultant, and what we did was we expanded upon the incentives portion, which talked a little bit about what type of, criteria would be necessary to encourage a developer to reach a 60 unit per acre capacity. In the downtown district. And so at the same time, Ray Greer, who is our consultant, had also added an FAR, a floor area ratio incentive to each of those criteria on page 3, and we will get to that. But let me also run through the other items. Last month, we also talked about a Highway 98 corridor, and we did talk about an area on Harrison between 8th Street and 98. So what we've done is we recrafted the ordinance. So we're not calling it a Highway 98 corridor overlay. We're proposing that it be called the Tourist Corridor Overlay District, and in essence, expand it to include that portion of Harrison that was expressed interest in last month. And then item 4, basically, we wanted to propose some exceptions one exception when it comes to tree protection. We've had some issues where heritage or champion trees have been removed in footprints of stormwater, and we know that it's almost impossible to work sites nowadays without addressing stormwater, and we do have a number of properties that we've had to yield to in order for them to develop the properties, simply because they couldn't mitigate the quantity of trees that they needed to take out. So we are trying to see if the board would be interested in allowing the stormwater pond to be one of the exceptions when someone is developing, you know, when it comes to heritage trees. So let me go back and quickly just talk about, or I should just ask the board, you want me to just run through these quickly, and or we could do a question and answer or whatever you're comfortable with.
Yeah, run through them, but let's ask the questions when we're in the section.
Okay.
And I noticed the one you just handed out had omitted the definition. They changed the impervious surface.
Yes, sir.
That is still being proposed, though, correct?
Yes, sir. That is.
Okay.
Yeah.
I've got a question on that.
All right. Well, let's
start out questioning your definition.
Okay. Yeah, okay. Let's talk about the building mass. You know, we're inserting the building mass because, you know, in the tourist corridor overlay, it does talk about some the building
that's
mass, and that is a new definition. So we are inserting that in the code and giving at least some idea of what that means. Now, we looked at our impervious surface ratio. Our current language talks about any surface or material which prevents the absorption of water into the soil, including building structures and pavement. And as we got to looking at that, we recognize that there are instances when people have pools that sometimes pools could act as a retention area.
Okay, that was my question. So that includes swimming pools?
That's how it's been interpreted.
Impervious. It's not considered in the impervious.
Right now, it is a pervious type use. It is a use that is considered as part of
until it
property.
Fills up and overflows. Then
that's
it's
true.
No longer
that's
impervious.
True. Okay. But here, you know, here's the thing. Most pools, when you start trying to do an impervious surface ratio, it is so minor.
Yeah.
You know, that it really doesn't play a major significant role. So we are just trying to see if there's any interest in.
Yeah, it's
in
probably
including
pretty well. Everybody, I was just curious about this.
Okay. Okay. So in essence, we basically are proposing the new definition so that. You know, it doesn't include the absorption of water into the soil. It basically would allow us to look at the pools and say, well, it doesn't include that.
Okay.
All right. Any additional questions on that? Okay. All right. And instead of trying to go through and discuss the downtown district area, that's why I just gave you a whole new deal or a whole new proposed section there, just so I wouldn't have to explain, you know, the changes. As we talked about, the only real adjustment was that page 3. On page 1, we do talk about the changes of the purpose. We did include the changes there. Under the item that talks about density, we talk about it being no greater than 30 units per acre. If a project utilizes the incentives as defined in Section E, then the maximum may increase up to 60. We've included an item 5 and a 6. We talk about restrict the residential districts from occurring on the ground floor of any developments directly facing Harrison, and the ground floor should be devoted direct or exclusively to commercial, retail, and office usage. Item 6, maintain and promote the historical architectural character. New construction shall utilize historic design elements that are complementary to the original historic character, and renovations to existing buildings shall try to retain historic elements and or add historic elements in keeping with the original historic-looking character of downtown.
Who makes that decision?
Staff. I mean, you know, it's it. And when I say staff, we work with the CRA downtown and downtown north on most every project that comes in, all four districts. So we work with the CRA staff and. You know, we recognize that there aren't any real key historical elements that basically have been outlined. But, you know, I guess at some point what we don't want to do is we don't want to see in downtown someone come in and put just a metallic Butler building right next to, you know, one of the brick two-story structures.
I agree.
And I think that that would be part of just working amongst the CRA and the planning staff to basically say, no, we don't believe that that's in the character of downtown.
The marina is in the downtown district, correct?
Mm-hmm.
We have no idea what these two proposals coming to us would look like. Are you saying that a large-scale hotel down here on the marina needs to look historic?
What we're saying is that we know a hotel will not come in and be a Butler-style building with metal facades. And again, that's the primary concern, is basically trying to at least keep some element of character. And believe me, over the last couple of years, we really have had some people who wanted to build some things that were really not going to be in character with downtown. So,
is now the time to discuss these incentives? Because it's sort of scratched out but referred to E.
I can move forward with those real quickly if you'd like. We're okay with 5 and 6, or I mean, you guys.
As long as we understand that there could be some tweaking when this overall plan gets approved by the city.
Certainly. I mean, and our intent is not to try to hold up those developers.
No,
I mean, we're simply here just trying to resolve a few things and trying to protect those developers from those who would like to make a quick dollar as fast as they can. Okay, page 2, item 5. The floor area ratio shall not exceed 2.0 and shall only apply to non-residential uses. If a project utilizes the incentives as defined in Section E, then a floor area ratio of 5.0 may be achieved. Item C, the following uses are allowed in the downtown zoning district unless otherwise specifically prohibited in Section D. Let's see. We did strike through where it says, additionally, projects which exceed 3 stories in height shall require a level 3 review. We recognize, and I think we actually have basically placed that in a different section here. We put it on page 4. It's the end of that downtown section. So, and no, we recognize that it will still be at level 3. It's just in a different position here.
Hey, what is, what's Harbor Village? Urban residential what? 1 or 2?
I'm not sure. Are we talking about insane?
Well, it's not even urban residential. What is, I'm just trying to think of what the residential part of this downtown allowable is. R1, which I don't see coming downtown. R2 or the MUs, but is that where we're going to build multifamily, or does it need to be greater than MU? Let's say somebody wants to come down here and build a condo. That's going to be what? Urban residential?
At this point, it's a downtown district. I mean, it is a, because it's here in downtown, it is an allowed use. And
so as long as we don't have to categorize it because it's in the downtown.
It is an allowed use.
Okay.
It is allowed within that district. And see, that was why it was so important for us to come back with a prohibition section, because we recognize that the downtown district has become the most flexible district that is in the city.
There's what's...
Yeah, we learned that.
Everything.
Right.
It's pretty much a catch-all for most districts here.
Okay.
Which segues into the next item, which talks about the following uses are prohibited. And, you know, I can walk through these. I will explain, though. You know, we had basically looked at other codes, and we recognized that, you know, in the downtown area, that other communities have the same type of prohibition in their downtown areas. And so this wasn't an attempt to try to pick on anyone. So if you recognize that some of these businesses are here, It wasn't simply to target them. It was simply just that we were going by some other codes, and we thought, okay, they sound great, so we'll start out with this. So I'll run through them quickly, and if you have questions, we can talk about them, or we can make some adjustments.
Yeah, let me make a statement first of all. Let me do the disclosure I talked about doing before each item, that I have talked to the owner of Friendly Check Cashing, Charles Bonham, and visited his site because of the concern that check cashing facilities are lumped in with car dealer payday loans and all of that, which is not the same. Friendly Check Cashing, at least, does not do payday loans or anything. It's strictly cash a check, and that's it. So I will disclose I have talked to him, and he has changed his opinion since last month when he was in favor of it, and now he's opposed to it. I thought he was going to be here today, but he did not show up, so I recommended him to come and talk. He may come to the city. I don't know. But my only issue is I'm torn on this because I have a problem targeting businesses, per se, versus aesthetics. I just think when you start lumping certain businesses into these categories, and the reason I'm torn is there are some businesses, certainly I don't think I'll be downtown. So I'm mixed on this, but I don't have a problem whichever way the board decides to go on this thing. It's just that I just got a heartburn with targeting certain types of businesses versus the idea of the aesthetics. So with that, unless everybody wants me to read these, we've seen them two or three times.
And keep in mind, though, what is already here is here. We're not going to target the ones
that's grandfathered in.
That's right.
They just can't come. If it burns to the ground, or they can't come in as a new one.
And as I mentioned to Mr. Bonham, his check cashing business is outside the downtown district anyways. It's down by Speedy Car Wash and that area. So I think it stops about the rescue mission, doesn't it? We had a map last time.
It's right there.
Yeah.
Actually, I think it's right where the pink and the red come together.
He's in the pink.
He's in the pink.
He's in the pink. So that's outside.
That's Vaselina Drive right there.
Yeah. So he's outside. The dark red is the downtown area.
That's correct.
So, but again, he went to great detail to explain what he does, and I saw it in operation, and but that be it as it may. Unless anybody, Mary, do you want to have him go through all of these?
Or, no.
Okay. That's fine.
Okay. All right. Moving on to the next item. The density and intensity increases may be granted within the downtown district in order to encourage and promote economic growth and redevelopment downtown. The density and intensity increases as described in items I through six below may be awarded to a proposed development meeting any of the following development incentives. I, rehab, rehabilitation, and or reuse of an existing historic structure, a density increase of 8 dwelling units per acre, a floor area ratio increase of 0.75. Item 2, maintain or provide dedicated public access to the bay or dedicated public easements along the shoreline, density increase of 5 dwelling units per acre, a floor area ratio increase of 0.5. Item 3, contribute to a network of parks and green space or include within the development of a public plaza and or courtyard. Density increase of 2 dwelling units per acre, a floor area increase of 0.25. Item 4, provide for multi-use solutions for transportation with an emphasis on alternate transit modes and pedestrian access and walkability. Density increase of 5 dwelling units per acre, a floor area increase of 0.5. Item 5, commitment to a green design or sustainable technology for both site design and or building. Density increase of 2 dwelling units per acre, a floor area increase of 0.25. Item 6, projects that provide for more than 25% of the total project as residential dwelling units. A density increase of 8 dwelling units per acre and a floor area ratio increase of 0.75. It talks about the highest achievable density increase is 30 additional dwelling units per acre for a project meeting and awarded for items I through 6 above. The maximum density cannot exceed a total of 60 dwelling units per acre. The highest achievable intensity increase is a 3.0 floor area ratio for a project meeting and awarded for items I through 6 above. The maximum intensity cannot exceed a 5.0 floor area ratio. An application must be made to the city that clearly identifies the requested incentives, the total density and or intensity increase being requested for the project, and specifically demonstrates how the proposed development meets the requested incentives. The city will evaluate each application for intensity and or intensity increase and will prepare a staff report with recommendations for a for award within 30 days of submittal. Item F, all projects within the downtown district which include a change for or a change to a higher intensity and or density use will be subject to a level 3 review before the planning board and city commission, and this determination shall be made by the director at his or her discretion. Additionally, projects which exceed 3 stories or 30 feet in height shall require a level 3 review. And that's pretty much the downtown district.
Questions?
Okay. So I own a building on Harrison Avenue, and I want to remodel it, not tear it down. I automatically get 8 dwelling units an acre?
Well, believe it or not, you automatically get 30. Outright, you get 30
but
units per acre.
But I get an additional 8 if I keep the building structure and maybe figure out a way to go up. Is that what you're saying?
You could. Yeah.
Okay. How do I reuse of an existing historic structure? Are we talking about the beams inside? Or are we talking about the walls on the outside?
Could be both.
There were a lot of semantics when it was last time, so I'm going to ask them up front now. So.
And Robbie, look, I'm just going to tell you, look, I didn't write this section. This is a Ray Greer written section.
But you're the one that's got to approve it.
I understand. And I'm here to say that, look, this is, I recognize it is a hard pill for a lot of people to understand. And, you know, I'll be the first to admit, even I have a tough time trying to understand this issue. At the end of the day, it is basically Ray took the exact same incentives or the exact same items that were in the previous language, and he just basically came in and added the floor area ratio and the density unit issue to it. He quantified to help at least bring some sort of a numerical type of a system to quantifying, if you will, the incentives. So, you know, I
do other. I was in a town this past week in a 10,000. They had a downtown that was hustling and bustling the entire time I was there. 10,000 people in Fairhope, Alabama.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, I'm just trying to figure out if a place like that has an incentive program, and there was none of the things that you're concerned about. None of those were downtown. It was all shops and offices, and it was just full of people. So are there people there that you could call, not necessarily there, but in other towns, other planners, and say, how does your incentive program work? Is it defined, or is it open to interpretation as each one? I just see that something like that, or number 3. Develop a public green space or a development within the plaza or courtyard. Well, you know, I can go put a little hut over here on the back 40 and say this is my green space, and now I'm picking up another 2 dwelling units an acre. That could be advantageous for me spending $5,000. I'm wondering if we're too vague.
I have some of the same concerns, because on one of the last projects that came to us, they were including a public, a courtyard for the use of their tenants, and so they would probably come back and argue that that would increase the density. And then, you know, I think we don't really define historic. Is historic what we say is historic, or is it based on registry in the National Registry of Historic Structures.
Yeah.
If I were the planning director, I would not want anything that said may, because maybe this project you happen to like, and so you suggested that all those incentives would work. But then this other guy over here, who's not you're not so fond of, you decide, no, I don't think so. So then politically, you're in this dilemma where you gave it to him, and so, you know, it's just, I'm still having some heartburn because I think it's still too loosey-goosey, especially things like, well, what's green and what's sustainable? And what, you know, what really are we saying as transportation, multi-use transportation? Because I provide a walkover from my parking garage to my building. Is that a multimodal, you know, maybe I put a moving sidewalk, okay, then bang, extra units. So we know, my concern is that we have this project that if you add these incentives, but where also are the things talking about you've got to provide parking and you've got to, do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
I just am a little, I wouldn't want to be the planning director and have a controversial project come to me and ask for incentives based on this. And they're going, well, it says you may, and, you know.
A lot of ambiguities in
there. Just a little bit of ambiguity.
A lot of.
Yeah, what, and is the public space, let's say they decide to go up here on Ecomfina and dedicate some land, or over in St. Andrews dedicate some land, but it's not in, you know, the downtown district, but it is very politically correct to protect the water supply for everybody. Do you get incentives?
I suppose when, at the end of the day, and I'm not trying to pass the buck. I mean, I saw this as a process where they would come through staff first, and then it would go to the city commission, and not, again, not to to punt or not to put all the stress on the city commission. But if you guys would like to make some additional exceptions to this to help us tighten it up, that's fine. But as I said, basically, what is here has been here, with the exception of the quantities, since the district was established back, I think, in 2011. I mean, so I really didn't add any of those, or go more detailed. I simply just had Ray pull them and just quantify it, or at least go into a process to reach the quantity of 60.
Well, it looks to me like you changed shall to may. That's really the major thing. You know, in the past, if they said we're doing this, then it kind of like you kind of had to do it. So now you as a planning director, and maybe we or the city as a board, have a little more discretion, but I still think it's a little too open to litigation, which is not where we
want to
be.
I think if there's one thing that we learned from the Marie Hotel issue was the argument that they made was that if the city puts it out there and they meet the obligation, their perception was that they met the obligation, the city's perception was that they didn't, especially when it came to incentives. So I think and I'm not typically like this, but at the same, I think we ought to define what really gets you that incentive. And I think your example of going out of the downtown district, it doesn't say it in there. I mean, you know, to go give up a piece of property, that's for public use. I think if they're going to do, you know, I think we ought to define, you get it for parking, you get it for use, you get it for public, you know, for public use or along the water's edge. I think those are great ideas, but let's define what we're talking about. And then that we won't have Derek Bennett standing in front of us saying, well, we did what you said. No, you didn't. You, 2 and 3 and 4 you didn't do, but 1 and 5 you did. It takes the heat off of you. And it helps us decide what project goes forward and not, or any future boards for that matter. Is that?
The verbiage needs to be more specific.
Specific, yeah.
And I will caution you, though, we went back and just changed a whole pile of shalls to may in the land development regulation about 9 months ago,
yeah,
just
did.
Because of that fact.
That's right.
Somebody said this things, you will do it.
But.
And we want to have the option. So I know what you're saying, but just caution if we flop it back the other way.
But didn't we do that on an overall basis, not in the downtown district? We're trying to concentrate.
It was in the development regs, wasn't it?
Yeah, but it wasn't just for the downtown district. We're trying to concentrate in an area of, we want it to look a specific way and feel a specific way. And I think here, being specific is better than not. The Marie Hotel may or may not have shown up if the language was correct, but there was a lot of reason for them to come back because it was so ambiguous. And that's all we've got to work off of right now.
Okay. Do we want to move on to the other items with that and make a determination when we get to the end and get all the issues out on the table first? Mm-hmm.
Well, I don't have any problems with any of the other issues, or the whole thing, if we can come back to that, to the incentive section.
Yeah, we can come back to that.
All right. All right.
Go ahead.
All right. Next proposed section is a new complete section. As I pointed out, last month, we called it the Highway 98 Corridor Overlay. In this particular draft, we're calling it the Tourist Corridor Overlay. I can walk through, just like we did the last one, if you guys want, or we can just we can talk about.
Okay, so on item B, where you define the district, it's basically the Highway 98, and then also
we've picked
Harrison
up
Avenue and all that down to 8th Street.
We picked up Harrison from 98 down to 8th Street. That's
right.
Correct.
Okay.
And that's the only addition to that.
So at some point in time, if you ever want to expand that to include Jenks or Beck or any of that, you would just come in and change the definition, basically.
Or the purpose.
Yeah.
Or okay. District, district definition.
The description would be modified.
Any items on that anyone wants to discuss?
No, I'm good.
How about landscaping? I think that's the place that we miss the most. This is the corridor that's taking us to the beach. This is the corridor that the tourists are coming and driving into town and checking out.
Yeah.
Go to Atlanta, Orlando, Tampa. Go to these big cities. When you go in there, some of the buildings you can't even see because the landscaping is so nice and so green and so big. And we say 10% of the front yard shall have trees. What about grass and bushes and a sprinkler system? Are we reaching too far to tell them to make it look pretty? In my world, you get one shot at looking good, and that's from the time you drive up. So,
okay.
I'm just throwing that out there.
Well, again, now our definition for landscaping includes all the above. I mean, it's just. We could get more specific if you so choose, but I mean,
I can put trees there, but I'll have to put grass there. I can put trees there, but I don't have to water it with an irrigation system. So when they die, I've got a bunch of dead trees that you made me put in and hope that God sends enough rain.
Well, interesting enough, by code, the code does already require that they put in the irrigation system.
Okay.
It's just not.
Should we reference that? That section of the code, just so that people understand that they're going to have to go do something?
We can.
I mean, you make a metal building look pretty with a lot of landscaping.
Yeah, that's true.
You're looking that up. Let me ask a quick question about transit facilities. At this point, you're basically telling anybody over 100,000 square feet, they've got to give you 100 square feet for a trolley stop. what you're getting, basically getting down to.
Yes, sir.
Does that involve any kind of requirement in any other part of the code that they have to pull off of the main road? Or can they still stop and block traffic on the road?
No, I think we would prefer by them giving it. And here's what you have in front of you. You have basically the Lynn Haven Highway 77 corridor overlay that's basically pulled from their code. And basically, when Walmart came in over there, they were instructed that they would put a
pull out, something like that, I understand.
And actually, they had to put a bus stop internally on the site. It wasn't even on Highway 77. It was internal to.
And that's good, because 23rd Street's a nightmare trying to get down it with the stops and stops and stops.
But again, you're talking about 23rd Street, and 23rd Street.
Well, 15th, though. We're talking about 15th Street.
And I recognize it. 15th actually has more cars than 23rd Street, predominantly along there. So, you know. But again, when I was thinking, we don't have right now, we don't have a lot of properties that can actually build.
Well, with that 100 square feet, would that give them space to actually have a pull in and pull out, plus a little covered area?
I suppose the only thing that would be comparable right now would be like the Lincoln Plaza. And we would probably say, okay, Lincoln Plaza, we want you to have a bus stop basically internal. And, you know, they've got little drive aisles in there, and they could pretty much designate a little space in there that they could, you know, pull off and pick the folks up on. So.
Yeah, because you can drive in and drive out on 15th Street right there.
Yeah.
The reference that you're looking for is going to be basically section 105-34.
Okay. I'll go read that tonight.
Okay. Right before bedtime.
Right before bedtime.
Okay. All right. It's actually called maintenance and irrigation section.
Maintenance and irrigation.
Yes, sir.
One question, how difficult would it be to get information from Fairhope?
Well, that's what I'm wondering. Can you call their land planners and talk to them about how they've done their downtowns? And
probably go online and pull up there.
I used to live in Mobile, so, you know, but you have to realize as well, though, you're dealing with a couple of different things. The interesting thing about Fairhope that most people don't realize is that Fairhope, I think it's a colony. And, you know, most people don't own their land. They lease their land. And there may be some sort of covenants that they may have tied to that. But I do know that they've got a planning department. They do have a zoning map and those sorts of things. But now you have to realize that their statutes are Alabama statutes.
Different than Florida.
But nevertheless, we can certainly take a look at that.
And I use that as an example because of where I was. But, I mean, we can go 3 hours east or south of here and stay in our state and find multiple cities that have done revamps of their downtowns, you know, and maybe somebody ought to take a field trip and talk to them or see them or look at them because they're hustling and bustling, and we're not. I know we're trying to get
there.
We have many things that should draw people.
Right.
I did look at a number of Florida ordinances, and I recognize that I wasn't quite sure whether we wanted to go, you know, jump into the water without, you know, walking through the shallow end first. And, you know, I didn't want to come in and immediately plop down an ordinance that was just super, super restrictive immediately. And I recognize the point that, yes, we are trying to clean the place up, and that's definitely our intent. I did recognize, though, that we're trying to attack this on a couple of fronts. We're also trying to approach the DOT about, you know, some of the landscaping type requirements that Lynn Haven and Panama City Beach, as well as the Highway 77 area in downtown North CRA, you know, with the landscaping and the medians. You know, it would be great if we can get some landscaping plugged in on the center part of that roadway. But again, I can go that route. I was just a little apprehensive about trying to plop down an ordinance right now that was just super, super restrictive. I mean, I thought we could probably come back and tighten it up. I just wanted to basically, my first intent was to primarily at least have the prohibitions out there so that we can come back in and stop some of the folks who were wanting to make a quick dollar on Highway 98. And
okay.
I mean that
I get that.
You know, we talked about, believe me, I looked at Walton County's scenic corridor overlay district, and I thought, no, that's going to be a lot harder for people to swallow that kind of restriction. And so
what is a bottle club?
It's basically where you walk in and you bring your bottle.
They provide the mixers.
You've
never been to a bottle club?
No, sir, I have not.
You've had a sheltered life, my son.
You certainly have.
Sean can take me to one?
One of the Carolinas was big on those because they could not sell alcohol in a lounge.
North
but they
Carolina
could sell your setup in North Carolina. I went to one I brought.
Well,
$10 for a Coke.
I have formidable years in North Carolina.
Yeah. Okay.
We don't have any per se that we know of, right? Yeah.
Not that I know of, no, sir.
Well, you'd be surprised how popular they can be.
Yeah, I said that we know of. Let me ask you, outdoor storage, I'm on page 6, where it says all outside storage areas, refuse removal areas, which I'm assuming is dumpsters.
Yes, sir.
Loading areas. Or displays of goods shall be screened from the view of all public rights of way. Displays of goods shall be screened.
That is, if they bring the goods outside, then and they have them placed like in front of their business,
right,
then it would be preferred that they have a hedge of some kind that would basically.
But if you can't see it from the right of way, why would you bring it out? I mean, you bring it out so people can see it, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I understand the dumpsters and if you're just storing it out there, but if you're putting it out there for people to see it so they can buy it, it's technically not a storage area, I guess. It's a display.
It's semantics.
It's semantics. But I can see you driving up to the granite place down there by Popeyes and saying, you got to get that junk out of here because it's, you know, you're displaying it. And I don't know the people or anything about it, but it's just one I noticed when I drove up.
There are a few places along Highway 98 that do display their goods directly out in front of their businesses.
Yeah, like George Gaynor's car shop. Maybe I'd put all his cars behind it.
Well,
I'm being facetious now, but people can get carried away. So I don't know how you think about that, but that was.
Well, it's hard to regulate every scenario. You know, it's just that we do need to draw the line in the sand somewhere at some point just to at least be able to raise the bar with some of our.
Yeah, I know, and there's a place on 23rd Street that's got a bunch of old junk stuck out in the front, old sofas and all of that. I don't even know if that's in the city. Of course, it's not in this corridor, but still.
It's
you want to stop that kind of stuff.
I agree.
I agree. What you're trying to
do. And trust me, the overlay for 23rd Street will probably happen in a little while, but we got to get this one first.
The old branch up. I don't know. I just, that one to me, displays of goods shall be screened, I think.
If you want to recommend.
If I get mad at somebody and I call code enforcement and this is in there, I guess I could theoretically have them make sure they put it all inside.
That's how it's enforced in some places, yes. The whole point is you don't necessarily need to drag half the store out in front of the place to get people's attention.
And, but if it's behind a glass and they can see it, it's okay?
That's fine. The intent really was talking about dragging it out in front of the location. And believe me, I can't name the business, but I know of several on Highway 98 that actually do that sort of thing.
This kind of goes back to what we've been talking about with the little bit confusing, because it just says displays of goods shall be screened from view from all public highways.
I
mean, you can't see it through a window.
Well, from a beautification standpoint, what you accomplish is from the window, hey, what you can see, but you've got a nice... You've got a nice drive going down, and it's not full of this.
I agree with the philosophy. I'm just trying to say it's open. So. Okay. Food for thought. Mike, our job is not to make you miserable. You know that, right?
Look, and I don't take it as such.
Okay.
You know, I'm here, though. I'm not only the planning director, I'm also the economic development director.
That's his job right there. And,
you know,
and he will do it.
I can only say, you know, the disclaimer is that, you know, if as the economic development director, there are inconsistencies. But, you know, that therein is the challenge.
Well, I think it's good you're both, because you can try to tie those two together. It makes good sense.
Well, I'm not trying to hustle to get the most generic language that I can. It's just a lot of times it is extremely challenging to try to make sure that we are moving forward, because some days, you know, we're in competition with a number of communities, whether we realize it or not.
Yeah.
And, you know, some days it is three steps forward, five steps backwards.
Yep.
Let me ask you one more question on number six. Projects may provide more than 25% of the total project as residential dwelling units. You get a density bonus of 8 dwelling units an acre. So if I come down here and build nothing but residential. Let's just say I buy that $4 million piece of property that the city wants to buy, and I build a 10-story condominium. That's all residential.
As long as you put commercial on the bottom floor. Go back to what we were talking about earlier.
That's only on Harrison Avenue.
Yeah.
But this is off of Harrison Avenue. Okay. This is on Beach Drive.
Okay.
So does that project qualify for 8 more units an acre? Because there's no, I mean, it's all residential, and you're saying it has to be 25% residential.
Yeah. We would consider the 8 units additional as an allowance for that, yes.
Okay. You would consider it, or that's a guarantee?
Well, at this point, we would basically endorse that, yes, as the staff. And then ultimately, the City Commission would have the ultimate decision on that.
Okay.
Right. Other questions?
No, sir.
No questions. Okay, we want to go back to the issue about the shall and the may and the vagueness of some of this. And how would we like to proceed with that? Suggestions?
Well, I think if we're going to talk about a historical structure, I think, like Mary said, we need to define what historical is.
From our perspective,
we don't have many of them here.
We need Bob Hurst in here. He'll tell you what historical is.
From our perspective, or by the state definition, a historic structure is anything that's over 50 years old.
That's almost everything downtown.
I know.
Right.
I know. And it could be a concrete block building. I mean, that is basically
the generic. But it's not protected per se by the historic.
We have no.
Like McKenzie House or one of those.
We have no defined historic district in the city.
There are historic buildings, though, because I've seen a list of them at one of these meetings we were at.
There was a historic survey that was done years ago, but it was put on the shelf, and nothing was ever done beyond that. They did the survey, and they never enacted any sort of ordinances to tie it to.
Okay, so somebody comes in, they own a building, they rehab it, not knock it down, use existing structure. We're saying because it's older than 50 years old, which we haven't defined yet, but let's just say that that was our thing, we automatically give them 8 dwelling units an acre.
Because or an increase in floor area, right?
Or an increase, but they can't really do that because it's, can they?
If they punch it upward, and they get an architectural design that mirrors what the previous structure looked like, then yes,
okay,
they could get credit for that. And like in the case with the Marie, I mean, if they were to go in and basically gut the Marie and use the exterior, or basically pulled all the brick off, demolished the structure, and then came back and replaced or put the same type brick on the first couple of floors and then found some brick to replace that, then, yeah, they would actually get credit for that.
Okay. I just think we got to have some more definition of what the guarantees are. You have to do this in order to get this.
But now also keep aware of the fact that the downtown and all the CRA districts, they are considered like special parking type areas, and that parking considerations are basically recognized for those areas. And, you know, you're going to have to be careful if you want to start tying, you know, parking to downtown and certain CRA areas, because, you know, the CRA, some of the discussions behind the scenes that they're having, they know that parking garages are going to have to be, you know, built in those areas in the future. And, I mean, the real question is at what point do you start trying to pass along, you know, the costs to, you know, the new business owners or even some of the those businesses that are trying to rehabilitate themselves. I mean, it just, that is the challenge. And, you know, the code does allow for the recognition that those CRA areas are special parking areas. So,
well, the city could build one and charge for it.
That's true.
Yeah. Okay. Mr. Chairman, I would like to make motion that we accept staff's policy of, where's that other one? What did I do with it? One point, it's back here. The definition of 101.3, the downtown district zoning of 104-35. With the exception of the density increases and intensity increases, I'd like to see that talked about some more. Maybe staff come back with some definition, less less open, ambiguous, and we vote on that separately.
That's item E.
That's item E. And also to add to the landscaping section that we reference the code of 105-34 for the tourist corridor section.
Okay, so the motion is approval with the exception of E and the addition of 105-34 under item L.
Yes, sir.
Landscaping. Okay, we have a motion. Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? Any thoughts from staff on that?
Any thoughts from the engineer?
Mr. McNeil, please come forward, state your name and address. Yeah, I didn't ask if there was any in the audience want to talk about it. I wasn't trying to ignore you.
It's okay.
Maybe.
Sean McNeil, 475 Harrison Avenue. Couple of questions regarding the corridor. And the 100,000 square foot of what type space would that be referring to?
It's primarily commercial space.
Retail, then? So there'd be more, in other words, I mean, 100,000 square foot of Walmart's a lot different than 100 square foot of a furniture store. So that's really, the thing that's also there is a landscape maintenance agreement that you actually sign notarized with the city when you achieve obtain a development order with the city. And the question I have about the overlay would be as well that are you going to require existing businesses to put in these landscape?
Not at the current time, no.
Have you considered that?
Yeah. That is a major can of worms, Sean, that I'm not prepared to jump on right now.
I believe, and I'm not positive, I think City of Panama City Beach did this. And, yeah, it is a can of worms, but, you know, if you want to clean up an area, that's how you got to do it. Anyway, that's your decision.
I'm taking baby steps with this one. I mean, I have no, at this point, this is being introduced at my level, and I have no authority by anybody at City Hall to be moving in this direction. So I'll be getting their input as this thing moves forward. But, you know, at this juncture, this is simply...
Of course, I don't want to relive bad memories around here, but some of this downtown district incentive program, have you reconciled it with the CRA incentives? And how do they jive?
No.
If not. No. And since every development order within a CRA must be approved by a CRA board, and the sitting commissioner is sitting a CRA board now, every development order has to go in front of them. So every CRA essentially has an incentive program. And now we have this downtown district incentive program for density and intensity. We have the CRA, which is overlaying the downtown district, St. Andrews, Millville, North, you'll probably have it all over the city by now. But they have their own incentives. And frankly, that confuses people. And there should be some expectation and anticipation with what we're going to see. There's going to be a consistent application of your rules. That was the most frustrating when we came to this board and the city board. And the thing I would also like to see, if you're going to have incentives and bonuses and with FAR, you know, intensity and density, I would like to see that you set up a program that would allow the developer, the property owner, to come as a right to this board and the city commission, CRA board, and ask them about those incentives without applying for a full development order application. To apply that, then they know what to really go to design. And I think it would actually enhance the city. I think you'd have good, frank discussions at this podium. I think you would have you would get to the point where you are after a few good fights, you know, probably, okay, we're just not going to allow that, but we're going to allow this, and we'll get there. But to have the developer propose development spend a lot of architectural engineering money, I don't mind, frankly, but I don't think it's the right thing they should be doing, and not to have some expectation of what they're going to achieve is real problematic. I have a real problem with the downtown district incentive program if you haven't reconciled it with the CRA incentive program. Because, therefore, now you have two governing bodies that can make two different decisions. And that's too much ambiguity. I appreciate it. Y'all have a great evening.
Thank you. That's a good point.
That's a very good point, Sean.
And that adds credence to the idea of maybe pulling that incentive part out. That's what we pulled out, right? Well, density and intensity incentives. Yeah.
So let me ask a question about the CRA incentives versus, I thought the CRA was about how it looks, not about how many units there are. Is that wrong?
Well, The interesting thing is Sean was the only one who brought out he was grasping with the CRA incentive type stuff. Now let me see if I can find it.
I mean, if I meet all of the criteria that's laid out in here on density, and my building looks good by the city, now you guys have got to approve it from the CRA perspective. But they're not going to talk about how tall it is or how many units are there, right? What are they going to talk about?
I think primarily they could argue that it doesn't meet, it either meets or it does not meet their CRA plan. And that's kind of to me, it seemed like that particular section, when you think about incentives, was really more toward monetary type incentives that the CRA may be willing to work on with a project. In other words, you know, they've got their various programs. They've got programs that grant programs where they'll pay for somebody to relocate to downtown. And to me, there are different kinds of incentives. Those are financial incentives, and then there are, I guess, development incentives, for the regulations.
But that's what we ought to concern ourselves with, are the development regulations.
And that's somewhat how I see it. But Sean grasped onto the word incentive, and he was trying to get the city to run with that program, or basically acknowledge that, hey, because your code says that your CRA your CRA districts have incentives, then you should basically be endorsing the Marie Hotel because it's in the CRA area. And, because that one section wasn't super tight when it came to spelling out what those incentives were, that's what he was basically using to wiggle in and use that as an argument. But, down in the downtown district, these are the these are more of the density / intensity incentives. And we can spell those out easier just by indicating that these are intensity and density incentives. But, it just seemed to me like when I think of CRA incentives, it's more financial, and them having their own little economic development programs to encourage development in their CRA areas.
Okay. So there are, though, incentives in the CRA.
Correct? That's correct.
Which we have no knowledge of.
No, when we pull them up, we don't have any control over those.
Yeah, the CRA board is primarily.
But those incentives could impact. Height was one, wasn't it?
That Sean wanted to use that, but no, the CRA.
So you're telling me that if we implemented these, even though we've got a motion to exclude them at this point, if they were implemented, they wouldn't conflict with anything that's in the CRA.
He wants to go there.
No, I want you to tell me.
Well,
I don't care what Sean says.
Look, our code.
You're our expert.
Our code is very vague. To some folks, that is bad. To other folks, that is good. It is challenging at best. But, it's what we've got to work with. Okay. And, we do the best we can with what we've got. And, sometimes it's easier for us to keep it vague in some instances. I mean, other times we need it. More restrictive. That's just the challenge that we work in. And, I wrestle with, do we really want to go to more restrictive? I don't know that we do. I mean, we're a redevelopment community as a whole, and we don't have a lot of development property that it remains. And, to some extent, the whole city really needs to be a CRA, but that's not
The downtown area encompasses two CRAs, right? Doesn't CRA North kind of loop around the north part of the downtown district?
That's correct, yeah.
And then you got the downtown CRA, okay. Okay, interesting. All right, so we do have a motion on the floor to approve with the exception of item E and then the addition of the reference on item L. We have a motion by Mr. Hughes, second by Ms. Sitman. Is there any more discussion on the board? And there's no one left in the audience that would like to address it, so we'll call for a question. Please take the vote.
Robbie Hughes?
Yes.
Carl Russ?
Yes.
Mary Sitman?
Yes.
Ray Dubuque?
Yes. Thank you. No other, what's that? No other items? Then the meeting is adjourned.